usability for mobile apps in emerging markets. So these are like few terms which I will be touching upon. So usability is one part, mobile apps is another part, and then we are also talking about the market. What is the emerging market? So before that, I want to introduce myself. So I'm IIT Madras Computer Science graduate. I've also done an executive entrepreneurship course from IIM Bangalore and few certification courses from IIT Kanpur. I work for Oracle, Satyam Research Group, Desidine. This was in a startup. I was heading the product development group for them. I had my own startup called MIT. And in recent past, I have been consulting with another startup called Vimagino. This is a product called WeHelp. It's live on Yatra, it's live on Pearson. And it's a recommendation cum chat engine. I have number of research papers published in very versatile areas, I would say, pattern recognition, speech technology, audio indexing. And I also write business and technology articles for this portal called Market Express. In terms of usability, I was speaker at UXINDIA last year. With Wipro Devices Group, CTO office, I discussed with them on usability for devices, medical devices, and also with Vodafone Innovation Lab. So with some of the mobile apps that they have, their focus is also in emerging market. So whatever startups which work with Vodafone, I discuss with them and help them define the features for their applications. And apart from that, whatever I do in technology, I'm also author of this book called Life, Odds and Ends. This was launched, this is a fiction collection of four short stories, and this was launched at IIT Madras last year. This year in January. This is also part of IIM Bangalore library, and these are a few places where I've given talks related to my book. So when I talk about my book, I talk about work-life balance, some of the balancing aspects, dimensions of human life. So these are pretty much, in August I was in the US, I spoke at UIUC, Midwest Panality Alumni Group, and CDOT, IIT, Triple IIT Bangalore, some of these places. I mean, last month I was in IIT Madras. There was a Golden Jubilee celebration, and I was into a panel discussion with Ambi Parmeshwaran and Krish. So World Book Fair Delhi and some of these things. And these are some of the media coverages related to my book, Deccan Chronicle, Times of India. So coming back to product usability in mobile applications for emerging markets. So, So when we talk about usability, so as I said, there are three things. We are talking about usability, we are talking about mobile apps, and we are also talking about emerging markets, right? So I will just very briefly touch upon all of them. So what is usability? As per Wikipedia, usability is ease of use and learnability of a human-made object. So if there's a bottle for me to carry the water, is it usable for me or not? Whether I can learn to open it or not, whether it is easy for me to carry. So those are the terms based on which I define the usability. Usability is defined. Then how usability? Is there any standard or is it any just a theoretical term? So usability, there is a standard called ISO 25010 in which we talk about two quality dimensions for a system or software product, if we have to measure their quality. So one is in-use quality, where we talk about more related to user experiences, like terms like satisfaction, how user feels when he uses. So there are five dimensions. I'm not going into detail. And then we talk about product quality. So when it comes to development, we talk about maintainability, we talk about portability, we talk about security. So again, there are eight dimensions in product quality, if you have to go to in detail of which I am not going. And one of them is usability. So usability is defined in terms of appropriateness, whether it recognizes the appropriateness of the product or the system, whether it is learnable, then operability, error protection, then interface aesthetics, that is where the UI part comes, and then accessibility. So this is how the usability. So if somebody has to get their system or software product ISO 25010 certified, then usability, they have to also care for usability, not just, okay, say maintainable, say secure, say very high tech or whatever. It should be usable as well. And then what are the usability factors? So if we talk about usability factors, there are two. One is emotional, one is rational. So, and typically when we take a decision of if we use certain products, we use a good combination of emotional and rational, both aspects. So if there's a chair, I have to sit. So it's a rational thing that I am tired, I want to sit, right? So it's a rational thing that I want to sit on a chair. But then if there are two colors, yellow and red, then somebody will prefer going and sitting on yellow. So that is when the emotional part comes, right? So whenever you make a decision, you buy a mobile phone, then it's not just, okay, it's a mobile phone. You have the emotional, you go for iPhone or you go for Android or you go for certain dimensions, certain things. And many times if you just go and think about your own decisions, you will see it's not just, okay, this is a rational component. It's an emotional, very good amount of emotional component that is used in taking decisions. So 90% of decisions are emotional, basically. So that is how, if we have to talk about usability factors of any product, any systems, any applications, we have to take care of not only the rational component, but also the emotional part of it. And then coming to mobile context, I will just touch upon a few examples and I will see how they were successful or what are the usability factors in those applications. Can anybody guess this image, what I'm going to talk about? Any wild guesses? Yeah, but in mobile context. Okay. No, actually, when mobile phones were first launched, so there were a few talks which I have attended, and I met those people who actually conducted those experiments to understand the user group for when laptops were initially launched. So these people, I mean, some of the founders of TED. So they basically made the laptops, went and sat with the people in the airport and asked them whether you will like using laptops or not. Before that, people were using desktops. So when mobile phones were initially developed and made, so the assumption was the target user group will be CXOs. Because those are the people who are in move, they have money, they will be able to afford the cost of the call and data. So that was the assumption. So when mobile phones were introduced to India like 15 years or 17 years ago, that time that was the target group. So some CXO, some high businessmen, high class people. So that was the target user group and that was the focus. And some people otherwise also had mobile phones. But then later when the purchase and data was analyzed, the very surprising data, I mean, the analysis that was done after the result of that data collection, that people have noticed the fishermen community in Kerala, as a group, as a community, they were the first ones to adopt mobile phones. And the reason for that was that they were able to understand the use case. So they were in the middle of the shore, and then some people sitting in the side, they are selling fish, and the price has to be decided based on what is caught. So if they sell something at cheaper price and then same thing is caught, again cashed, and then basically there's a, so they were able to understand, okay, they can fix prices based on what is caught and they can maximize their profits. And they were able to make business, they were able to make profit out of it in spite of the fact that that time mobile phone calls incoming was also expensive. And in spite of all those issues, all those scenarios, they were able to make profit. And this was never thought. So people who launched, who built mobile phone, who were into marketing, they never thought who could be the user group. So this is one aspect I want to highlight. So when we talk about usability, when we talk about user group, many times it's beyond our imagination. Then SMS feature in mobile phones. That was again developed based on the difficulty that this engineer was going through. He was staying in Netherlands, and every time he has to communicate something when mobile phones were in initial phases, so he has to wait for the signal to come, and many times he used to keep on taking his mobile phone and go in all the corners to catch the signal, and it used to take many times in 6 hours, eight hours also. So he thought there has to be a better way where if I have to just communicate some few words or one or two lines, it did not involve my engagement, right? So that is when he thought of developing that feature, and SMS came in picture. So that was pretty much need-based invention. Then we talk about Bluetooth speakers. Again, we save hassle of wires. If I'm talking, I need not carry this heavy thing with me. So if it has to be wireless and things like that. And apart from that, being a mother, I will tell you another use case, another scenario which typically people will not talk about. Like my daughter, she is just 4 years old, and many times if you have the mobile phone, she'll just catch it and she'll never want to give it back. right? So she will just start playing games and all those things. So if I have to play a music or any kind of thing, I'm like quite scared to pull out my mobile phone that before her, because otherwise she will just hold it and she'll never want to give it back, right? So she will be with the playing games for 1 hour, 2 hours and things like that. So again, with this kind of product, you see, okay, you are playing a song, you just play a song, and then you connect on the Bluetooth speaker and it plays, and you can carry it anywhere, right? So you talk about, so there's just one product, and then you talk about so many use cases, so many aspects, and so many usability. So these are usability, real usability issues. So when you talk about usability, it's not just a rational thing, as I said in the beginning, it's also the emotional component. And we also talk about those five dimensions that I showed in the usability, error protection, aesthetics, and everything. We talk about everything. Then this is one more iPad app. This is, assuming all of you who are wearing specs, you know how difficult it is to go and select a frame for your specs, right? So especially when you are going for the first time, there will be thousands of things kept, so many brands, so many price points. And even if you select, sort out like five of them, or maybe three of them, picking one is so difficult. And even if you pick one and come home, you always think at least for a few hours that, okay, other one could have been better, right? So because it's difficulty in comparison, you wear, then you rely on your memory, then you wear other one, and then you compare, right? So there's a lot of stress associated. And in marketing also, there's a term called post-shopping trauma. So you don't want to go through post-shopping trauma. So again, there's an app where you compare. So it helps you compare, right? And then we talk about virtual trial room. So it's not only on the desktop, but also on the mobile phones. So all these applications are basically enabling users to live a better life. And this is a theoretical discussion that I want to disclose to you, that in last UXINDIA conference, I was speaking with somebody, and they had this, the person had this idea that for kids, if I have to enhance their language, so his idea was that, okay, very similar to the way we do crowdsourcing, we have an app where anybody can just come and submit data. So example, if I want to know how Apple is pronounced in various languages, various places, so you come and submit how you call Apple in Kannada, I come and say save in Hindi, and somebody comes and submit data in French. So like that, it will be a good data repository for language for kids to learn. And when they play through that particular app, they will see the visual, they will see the picture, and they will also learn the language. So that was the idea. But then again, based on my daughter's experience, I immediately pointed out that instead of the having the iPad app, it's better to have the real toy. So if we talk to Fisher Price or somebody else, use the same technology, use the same connection points, but instead of having the app, it has to be a real toy which speaks, which talks. So it basically does not bother people to like, and kids, for kids also, other skills, other abilities are developed. So some of these things, just now I booked my cab using my Meru cab mobile app. So when you log into that, it shows that five cabs are nearby, and you basically know, okay, I have to book in a hurry or I can wait for some time. So all those relaxing, I mean, these are just soothing factors that you are getting, and these are emotional. So rational is one part, emotional is another part. That is what I'm trying to highlight. Then again, WhatsApp, very similar to iMessage in iPhones. And everybody is using, people talk about WhatsApp. People write an email, or people put a Facebook post and say, okay, share your phone number, I will send you this data by WhatsApp. Flipkart, again, leave the recent whatever has happened last 1 week. So Flipkart, again, their mobile apps is giving them more profit as compared to their desktop app. And again, the reason for that is if you just do the psychoanalysis of how people shop, then when somebody is shopping on the desktop, they will have bigger screen, they will be able to see more choices, and they have more time, and they can compare, right? So when they compare, many times people get confused, they don't buy, they don't make a purchase decision. But when they are working on their smallest screen, they are on the go, and many times they are in the hurry of closing the thing, they don't have many choices, and it helps them make decision making. So many times, like, too much is like not good, so more is less is more, so those concepts come in here, and this mobile app helps them make profit. And that is when they give you discount when you go on mobile apps and use that. Then Angry Bird, again, is my very favorite example, because it's not just a game that was run, it's not just a science that is behind it, it's the whole technology, whole market, everything that is developed around it. So you get games, you get purses, you get chappal, you get t-shirt, you get bedsheet, you get curtain, you get everything with Angry Bird. Recently we went to Tirupati and there was this outside one temple, there was a small these shops and they sell things for 10, 20 rupees. And there also I saw one pen with Angry Bird logo. So it has reached everywhere and everybody knows Angry Bird. And that is the reach of an application. So now, when we talk about market, so if I talk about mobile, then everybody thinks, okay, this is something great. And nowadays we are so used to have a smartphone. And then if somebody says market, we think of, okay, next Flipkart or next Angry Bird or next something, right? So that is how the mind works. But is it so? So this is a study that is done. And this is there on this website called QZ.com. And the way it shows that if you see the numbers for the developed countries in 2005, the number of mobile phone subscribers were around, say, 80. And now the growth is in 2013 is 120 plus, right? So if you see the percentage increase, you see 50%, right? But if you see the developing countries, then in same numbers like 2005, you see the numbers were around 30 and now it is around 90. Right? So you see that like three times is growing. So where is the growth? The growth is in this particular developing countries. And again, logically also if we think like in cities, typically people have smaller families. There are two members, three members, four members. That is how people stay. Each of them will have their mobile phones. And that is not going to grow. Maybe you will have two phones, one for office, one for home. Maybe you will replace your phone, but not that you are like growing in numbers. But in villages, in rural India, in semi-urban cities, and if you see the scenario there, there's a family of 10 people. Not just 10 of them will be staying in same house, but many times they will share phone. So it's a number for associated with one person, but everybody is using, 10, 20 people are using. And tomorrow when they grow in terms of their financial abilities, when they are able to spend, then two more will buy mobile phones. So again, this one will grow to three. So that is how the growth is happening in developing countries. And if you see these numbers, if you see that growth, then you see, okay, the growth is in that market. So obviously there's a market where we talk about Redbus, where we talk about Meru Caps, mobile apps, where we talk about Flipkart, Angry Bird, and things like that, and which is giving profit. At the same time, there's a growth at which people are not looking at in that extent, and people are not focusing, especially when we talk about startups. Everybody wants to do some high-tech startup. But high-tech, is it? Do we also think of the market where the growth masses are there? So that's the point. And so that is when I'm highlighting on emerging markets. So what is emerging market? And this is again as per UN, United Nations. These are the goals, these are called Millennium Development Goals. And they are eight in numbers. And that they say that if we achieve these goals, that is when we are called developed. So if we say, okay, developing countries, developed country, what is the difference between developing and developed countries? Then developed countries, typically these problems are not there or less. Developing countries, these problems are there. So if tomorrow I buy a better car, am I developed? Probably you will say yes. But if some village, maybe nearby villages, they have better, say, electrical condition or maybe water supplies or maybe food conditions, then if we call, are we developed? Truly, how many will go for option one or option two? How will you call development? How will you rate development? Obviously, everybody will think, okay, everybody will go with, okay, option two is the real development. Maybe we are not directly associated with that, but at the end of it, that is what is development. And if we go through them, then priority-wise, we talk about hunger, we talk about extreme situation will be Somalia and Taliban. But otherwise also, hunger is one thing, and having the nutritious food. So it's not just okay having this roti, pyaaj, and hari mirch, but also balanced food. So that is the first priority that is to be achieved. Second is education for all. Third one is when we talk about empowerment of women. And this is again very important point that I want to raise. It's not just okay empowerment of women in the rural India or empowerment, rural India women work, they go to work, okay, so it's not about working. Whatever working conditions, whatever employment is there, women also work. So it's not about just working, but it's about empowerment, it's about decision making ability, it's about coming out and standing for your rights, right? And that is not bad only in rural or semi-urban countries, it's there everywhere. I read Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg. She is Facebook CEO, and she also talks about some of the women issues. So it's not just, okay, this is there in India, this is there in the US as well, and this is there with the educated women. This is there with the women who are most, I would call empowered or more authorized to take decision. Even then they talk about, so somewhere this is there. So it's not just, okay, glassy ceiling is not there, sticky floor is not there. It is there, and this also has to be addressed in various markets, especially in the rural or semi-urban markets. Then we talk about child mortality. Again, there's a data that very few, very recently there was a TV ad that somebody is celebrating the, I forgot which one, but somebody was celebrating the birthday of their child that he has crossed the 5 years. How many of you have seen that, right? So the,
his dad used to.
Right. He goes like, right. Right, yes. Yes. Yes, yeah, so very few kids, I mean, especially if we talk about rural India and all, there's a great number of kids who are not crossing the age of 5 years. So that's the point. So child mortality is another important aspect. Then we talk about maternal health, we talk about some of these difficult diseases, we talk about environment, and then we also talk about partnership and development. Recently, Narendra Modi ji visited US and he talked about make in India. So that's the number 8, but before that, we have to cross all these 7 as well. So these are some of the applications. So any questions till here before this? Anybody wants to? Okay. So, come forward. By the way, I have my books with me. So 3 best questions will get my book. So for latecomers, I just want to very briefly repeat that we, as of now, we have spoken about usability, what is the usability, and what is the usability in terms of mobile applications. And we discussed some of the applications like Angry Bird, WeChat, and some of these applications when it comes to, and we and then we are talking about emerging market. So it's not just there's a market in urban India or in the US, but also there's a rural market, and we are talking about their needs and how they live and what are the kind of requirements that they have and what are the applications. Then comes the applications, how technology can solve their problem. So that is what we are talking about. And so this is one of the applications. This is done as a project in IIT Kanpur. There's a lab called Agropedia Lab. And this is called VKVK, Voice Krishi Vigyan Kendra. And what happens in this is there's an expert and there's other farmers. So they get the advice on phone using their mobile phones. And some of the application, when I was with Satyam, that time also, there's a echo? That time also there was a project in which these farmers can basically take a picture of the crop and send it to the expert, and expert will analyze and send the report. So some of these, many companies, many people are working on some of these applications, and I'm quoting this one. So here there's a expert to farmer connection, and if they have any problem, any guidance required, they can call up expert and find. An expert can also broadcast a message to the farmers, something is going to happen, and if something is to be used for everybody or general public. And this is another, this is called POP, Package of Practice. And this is some kind of learning for farmers. So somebody who is growing wheat, and then he thinks, okay, let me grow parval, because that is sold expensive, I can make more profit in that, but he doesn't know how to grow, what are the conditions, what are the kind of soil or environmental condition required to do that. So he can basically go through this site and read. And not only read, he can also listen, because many people will not have the ability to read. And again, it will be in the local language. So this will be there in the Oriya, this will be there in the Hindi, Kannada, some of these languages. And it's there in practice. So like about 50,000 farmers are using these applications. So what is the structure behind that? So there's a digital library. So this is called content, certified content, Gyandhara. and then these are co-created. So again, there's a social aspect. So some of the time, expert will create the content. Many times, these are created based on social. So some farmer, if they report a thing, then somebody has to basically analyze and then put it. So these are co-created. And then there's a social network aspect of it. So this is the phase one, where the data is created or generated. And then comes to phase two, where you see this E to F is expert to farmer, F to E is farmer to expert, and third one is, E to is expert to expert, these kind of communication, M to M, mobile to mobile, W means web, web to mobile, SMS voice. So basically people can receive SMS, people can send SMS, people can take a picture and send through SMS, and they can call up, they can ask, they can listen. And then there's a VKB net, and there's a mobile upload, so they can upload. So again, this is for multi-purpose. One is for reporting, like somebody takes a picture of the crop or some leaf and sends. This is also for learning, that somebody wants to learn something new. They can just log into the thing and learn and get the expert help. And this is also for the broadcasting. So if expert thinks there's a new pesticide that is there in the market which is useful for this area or this locality, he will just broadcast a message to all the farmers and they can get it. And this is one more app that is called Digital Mandi. This is again in the developed in the IIT Kanpur. And the way it works, think of a scenario that there's a farmer in village A and he has to sell his crop. So one morning he wakes up and he wants to go. He has three options, village B, C, and D. All are assuming these are the three markets for him. And all are equidistant. So he has no means to decide where to go. So by his intuition, he just goes to B. And he sells his crop and comes back. In the evening, somebody else meets him and he says, C market was giving better price for this particular crop. So then he realizes that I was in loss. So how does he decide? So that kind of use case, that is the scenario for this particular farmer. So basically, he can come to this Digital Mandi software. He can register himself. He can register his preferred crops, assuming he's working with some three fruits or some three grains or vegetables. So he can register them. He can also register his preferred markets. And then he can also register which days he wants to get the SMS. So those SMSs will come to him. And then he will be pretty much up to date, pretty much like economic times, that what is the market, what is the prices, and then he can decide where he wants to go, which is more profitable for him. So you think about those farmers who are working and just think of improving their lifestyle or improving their problems through technology. These are very simple solutions. Then coming to finance, M-Pesa is very much known to everybody, so I should not go into detail, but again, when it was initially done, the problem was that farmers, when they work and they get their money, they have no means to deposit their money in a bank. So typically they have their money, which can be stolen or something. Many times they will give it to some local landlord or somebody who will give them some interest. But again, there's a question of trust, or there's a question of somebody lying and somebody not giving the appropriate right return at the end of it. And if they have to go to a bank and deposit their money, then they have to lose their salary for one day of work they have to lose. So that was a pretty difficult scenario. So this M-Pesa pretty much kind of solved this problem. This was initially tested in Tanzania, and then it has like now pretty much everywhere. So farmers just go to M-Pesa, some store, and deposit their money. Again, equivalent, not the mobile app, but Polaris lab in Chennai. So they have also done a solution for similar problem. So for them, they have built this robot called Robin. So Robin is like 6 feet tall, and they call it She. So Robin, this is like pretty much self-sufficient bank branch. So this robot, whenever they have to go to a village, so days are fixed. So assuming this particular 15th of this month, Robin comes to your village. So you know. So this Robin will come, you can deposit money, you can withdraw money, you can issue draft, or whatever possible, whatever situations are there. So Robin does everything. So there's a hardware solution as well for the similar problem. So, and this is M-Pesa, how initially people were trained to use M-Pesa. Then comes the education. So we discussed like agriculture, we discussed finance, and I'm just touching upon three sectors. Education is the one more. So just think of this particular scenario where kids are in a classroom. They are reading, they are trying to understand, learn something. And any guesses like how we can include any technology to enhance their experiences? Anybody wants to say anything? Through mobile, but assuming electricity conditions are very poor, and even people don't know how to use mobile. Many people, I mean, if we talk about some of our aunts and all, we'll know some of them will, even with old phones, they will not know how to dial the number. They will say, okay, SMS here, but I don't know how to see, right? So we are talking about that the population class. And then again, teachers, how they have to be like upgraded, trained. Okay. Yes. So basically everybody is thinking now. So pretty much there are quite a few projects, again similar projects, and they are being run not only in India but also in some other countries. And one of them is called Teaching in Pocket. So that's a project that is for teacher upgradation. And this one that I'm going to show, this is called Aptus. So there's an academy called Khan Academy. And they have developed this particular thing. It's called Aptus. So one of them is like server and one of them is router. So you talk about this particular place where lighting power conditions are very poor and there's no connectivity. Recently Mark Zuckerberg said that connectivity is human right, but how you provide connectivity? It will take 5 years, right? So this is the solution for connectivity, right? So this is this can be charged very fast. This also have a solar charger. So you charge it, so even if electricity, many times power doesn't come for 2 days, 3 days, right? So this can be charged using solar power. And one of them is server, one of them is router, and server has all the study material, and this is stored in the WordPress format, and there's one more Moodle format for this particular thing. And they have all the data available, and this is used for teacher training. This is also used for creating connectivity. So assuming all of them will be given one iPad or some of these devices, and some of these small devices, and then this particular router will create the internet connectivity for them where they can read, they can learn, they can play, so they can understand. There was another project which is called Holes in the Wall. That is, there's a TED talk on it by Professor Sugata Mitra. If you search for this word called Holes in the Wall in Google. So that is again very interesting. What he has done somewhere in the slum area near Delhi, he created these holes in the, literal holes in the wall, and he has put desktops in the wall. So there's a hole, there's a monitor, there's a keyboard, there's a mouse, and just kept. Nobody is there. So this is there in the slum area. So when next morning kids come and they see something is there. People are just walking around, people are staring at it. Some kids come and they try to touch it, feel it. And within few days, what they have noticed, these kids have learned to browse. There was no training, there was no teaching. These kids have learned to browse on this hole in the wall. So what he says, this whatever teaching methods that we are using, whatever classroom structure, whatever he says standard one, standard two, and then IIT JEE and things like that, all this is pretty much old. You give them this free learning environment where people learn based on their need, based on their interest, based on their convenience, based on their when they are most alert during the day, and they will learn. So everybody has the interest in learning. By, I mean, sometimes we are lazy, but otherwise, I mean, we want to learn, we want to grow, we want to evolve, right? So everybody will learn, but you need not define this structured way of doing learning. So there's a new way, and this is the example that he says to prove his point that, okay, there was no training, these kids learn. So when these kids in slum area who have never seen a computer, who have never seen a mobile phone, they can learn, anybody can learn, right? So again, some of these, so when we talk about education, we talk about emerging market, we talk about some of these kind of solutions. So quite a few projects. There's a MoMath project, again in, I think somewhere in, forgot, in South Africa. And that is again for enabling, enhancing the mathematical ability for students. So quite a few projects. So if somebody wants to know more, they can get in touch with me. I can share links. And this is again one example of this person is on the go. He cannot stop working. But at the same time, when he's going, when he's taking his crop to the mandi, he can learn on the way. pretty much like he wants to learn about parval ka kheti, he's learning, he's listening to it, right? And then local language and those things. So these are the three areas, three sectors that I wanted to cover for emerging market, and wanted to show how mobile phones, or how applications related to mobile phones, or not just mobile phone, otherwise also, how they can help improving their lifestyle, and how they can basically, how they are being used, and how companies are working on it. And now when it comes to execution part of it, so we have just seen theoretically what is the market and what is being done, and how do we do that. So what is the infrastructure? How many of you are from development background? Okay, so this I'm just showing for reference. This I'm not going into detail. So this is what we talk about: SMAC, we talk about social, we talk about mobility, we talk about analytics, and we talk about cloud. And I'm just introducing these terms, everybody knows it. And there's an article of mine also in the Market Express, if you search, you will get it. So social, you saw in the very first week example, there was also a social component in that. So social is not just Facebook, social is like in various aspects, we can talk about, somebody says, okay, this is happening, somebody says, okay, this is happening with me also, and then everybody talks about it. Then they basically try to come to some conclusion and some kind of understanding about what is happening, and then solve the problem, or understand, okay, where is the problem is. We talk about mobility, everybody is on the go, not only in the urban cities or CXOs, but also in the, there's a farmer who is on the go, right? And we also talk about analytics, because it's very difficult to define rule-based systems when we talk about this kind of diversified solution. So we have to go for machine learning, neural network analytics, some of these technologies, and then cloud is a way to store data, to compute, and so. So this is the infrastructure. When we have to talk about, we talk about usability, we talk about mobile applications, we can talk about any market, we can talk about rural market, we can talk about urban market, and this is the infrastructure that is there to solve the problem today. And then methods. So this again, very briefly I'm touching upon, not going into detail. So when we have to solve the problem, first of all, analysis and research, we need to understand what we are trying to do and for whom, what user wants, who is the user. So we just saw the needs of emerging markets. We understood the millennium goals defined by UN and what kind of problems they are facing, and how now we can understand how the technology can be used to solve their problem. And then we talk about design thinking, some of these technologies. We do theoretical research, there's a laboratory research. This is one example to understand, assuming there's just see this particular slide. And some of you will focus on this point, some of you will focus on this point. So how do I know where to put the most prominent information, right? Or something that I want everybody, eye tracking, yeah. So eye tracking, and again, this is for, this is called heat maps, this one. So this is to understand, so this was an example of Google, so where to put the ads. So this is like highly selling. So if you want to put some, everybody, majority to notice what you are putting, you have to put in the. So these are again based on hand movement and user clicks. And then we talk about the screen sizes. So again on mobile phones, again with various screen, you have various varied screen sizes. Then how people use, what are the usability. So again, you can do a lot of study, a lot of research, and basically understand, okay, what is the right way of providing. So again, if you talk about development, again, there's a lot to do. And if you talk about usability, you talk about user experience, again, there's a lot to understand. And these are the methods. And now, this actually, I covered in my presentation last year in UX India, and this I will just very briefly show what it is. So I'll just set the background. And so assuming nowadays we have all these smart devices, we have mobile phones, we have these wearable devices, watches, gadgets, and then we, humans, are there. So at one end, we use devices the way we want. On the other hand, if you also see, sometimes you will feel that devices are basically kind of controlling you, right? You, yeah. So how many of you have seen the movie called Matrix? Yeah, good number. So again, you see, okay, these devices are controlling and all these cyber. So these are not just movies. There's a very good concept, philosophical thought that probably the director or producer or the writer of the story script writer was trying to convey. So basically what they are saying, okay, there's something to assist us, but at the same time we need to know how to use that. And if we are not intelligent enough to use it, sometimes they will overtake us or maybe control us the way they show in metrics. And that is happening even now. There's a model called Hooks model that is studied by this scientist called Nirial in Stanford, And he studies how people get hooked to their devices. So assuming you are going in lift and you see two people are standing. So there's hardly a time window of say 20 seconds, but still people pull out their mobile phone, see and put it back. Sometimes, I mean, again, there's a lot of analysis why it happens, how people get hooked to devices. People not feel happy if they don't see their Facebook updates. Morning they wake up, first thing they want to see is, okay, who has liked my post, who has done this, who has done this, right? So email checking many times is more than like a requirement, it's an addiction that is happening. So that is the bad part of it, but good part is how do we make it happen? How do we understand that we can develop right applications that can, assuming I understand these all these problems and all these thoughts, then how do I develop that application so that it helps user to do right things, right? So user does not be in the strain to understand, to take the decision, to correct his behavior, but the application basically does that thing. And this area, this stream of study is called captology. And here, the person, if there's time, we can go into detail of it, if there's interest, but as of now, I'm not covering. So I'm just mentioning it. So there's a stream called captology, which basically tries to understand what is the connection between these smart devices and human brain, and how do we develop applications to help, basically these applications will enable that behavior in the user. So assuming if you are booking your ticket in the Make My Trip, and it shows you that alert, okay, few seats are left or prices are going to go up, you will end up booking ticket. So this alert is nothing but enabling you to do the thing, right? So this is a very naive example of doing that, but there can be. So we study motivational factors of these humans. We also study ability aspect of the humans. So some people are kind of lazy. They cannot like work very hard. Some people are kind of slow thinker. So they can work hard, but they cannot think very fast. So all of us have different ability. For some people, time is a constraint. For some people, money can be a constraint, right? So understanding the ability parameters, understanding the motivational abilities, how do we create those appropriate triggers in these devices or these applications so that they enable user to do right things? That's the concept, that's the study. And so coming back to, this was my goal, or this was my thought, that using these smart devices, using captology or whatever, machine learning, analytics, cloud, SMAT, or design thinking, some of those techniques, whatever is required to enable or help improve lifestyle of people living in the developing countries or in the emerging markets. So that's pretty much it. And so with that, if there are any questions, I'm happy to take them.
If you say suppose Hindi, Oriya, or any other things, so how do they communicate with that app? Or I think many of farmers, they do not have smartphones also.
Yeah, so basically we have to do solutions for them. So this is not like asking them to go through some training, which we can create. But again, whatever comes naturally to us, that is what we will do. Motivation again works only up to some limited extent. You may give me some offers, a sale is going on. Initially when the sale comes, you buy. But if sale comes 20 times, you will not end up buying. Because you know it is like every month it is coming or something like that. So motivation and ability and some of these things. So when you say, okay, farmers, they have to be educated. They will be educated up to some extent. They will see, like you see this example of fisherman in Kerala. So some of them will see their benefit and they will get educated by themselves. You will not even know. But on the other hand, you also have to understand what are their living conditions, what are their abilities in terms of environmental, working condition, mental ability, various kind of, right? And then what kind of solutions you can give to them? Like Aptus was a very good example. You see all the environmental conditions, you don't say, okay, government has to create some big power plant there and create electricity. They say, okay, this is the condition and this is the solution, right?
So that is how these solutions have to be created. And not just in the rural India, again, all these studies were conducted in terms of finance. In developing countries, in countries like India, 60% of adults, 60% of adults do not understand the meaning of word term interest. Many of us will be very poor investors just because we do not understand. Right? So these are the living conditions that we are living with. And at the same time, we are doing our work, we are also taking care of our livelihood, family, and various aspects, our hobbies, gymming, exercising, reading newspaper, everything we do, right? Now, in this particular, whatever is happening, in between, how things have to be improved for all classes. So I discussed some of the problems that emerging markets were facing. We are also talking about these urban markets, for example, this Meru Cabs or WhatsApp. These are the applications for urban markets, and not just urban markets, but semi-urban as well. So that is how we have to understand the market.
And one more thing, see, if those applications have kind of voice functionality just present, it will say that what you do, like in their language, local language. Maybe like you want to upload something or you want to upload some pictures. So I think that would make some.
Yeah, that happens. So long ago, I mean, this was around 4 or 5 years ago that I've seen one of these presentations by Google. And what they have done, they have carried this bus to villages. And this bus has the ability for people to come and talk. So basically, there are no laptops, there are no desktops, there's no connectivity. So this bus is like self-sufficient within it, and people come and talk. And that was some means of understanding their language. So this is pretty much speech to text, text to speech. So people come and talk, and this will be converted to text, and this will be transmitted, and it will be read back to other end. So some of these experiments, some of these things were done even years ago by Google, companies like Google. And these applications, the examples that I've shown, voice ability is there. So, and nowadays, like we even on our
How much user research was done because for such such applications? Because I believe that not only one village, you have to go to like really a lot of villages to do user research and come up with collective data and then come up with a solution. So, how much user research was done? What challenges has faced? Is there any? Do you have any insights
on
that?
There's this organization called COL. So this is called Commonwealth of Learning. They do a lot of research in this emerging markets. Vodafone is focusing on emerging market for mobile apps nowadays. And there was also this project for Government of India. It's called Data Project. And everybody was focusing on it. So there was a lot of data created by Government of India, so they keep on collecting data, fingerprint, population data, age, photographs, and various kind of data. And they do not know what to do with that data. So everybody was focusing on it in IIT, IIIT. I have spoken to those people. They wanted to understand how we can understand this data. And again, based on their background, somebody will think, okay, we can use this data to create, better policy for some of these officials, CIS officers, and things like that. So basically, they can understand those graphs, they can understand those patterns, and they can say, okay, this area requires this particular kind of facility, right? And somebody else is thinking of some other. So a lot of data, a lot of reports are there. So if you have interest in working in that area, then obviously those reports are available online. And then again, based on your interest, you can take deeper. A lot of high technology products like computer vision projects. So there was this area in Northeast where they had to, like Google Maps, all of us use. So this area required some kind of, this was actually a confidential project, so I do not know many details, but basically it was that this area is requires some kind of image understanding using satellite imaging. And people cannot basically go there because this is like highly, next slides are there and it's difficult for people to just. So only major satellite images were available and they had to analyze data and then they had to solve. So some of those problems, some of those projects are there. And companies are working with companies. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so quite a few people in IIT and triple IITs, they work in some of these projects. Like whatever examples I've shown, they were from IIT Kanpur, but all of them, except M-Pesa, all of them were like, which were done in Ecopedia Lab and some other labs in IIT Kanpur. So they work in other IITs, in IIT, this data project that I mentioned, Government of India, that I spoke with somebody in triple IIT Bangalore, and he was very keen in understanding how do we understand this data and how do we define the policies for the government officials. So many, so if you can find connects and if you can understand who is working in that area, you can directly connect with that faculty. But many times they have their own research problems in mind. And I have been working with startups in past 6-7 years, and the way I work, if I have to get some students to solve my problem, as part of like my company, I will place an ad and I will connect some of these IITs and some of these colleges, and people respond. So many times you did not even call them, you just talk to them on phone and you tell them the problem, and these students, they are very smart, they solve the problem, I mean they understand. So once you show them okay what is required to be done, they will do, and you can pretty much do it remotely, and at the end of it you can show them some certificate. If possible, some financial support as well. So they stay in their hostel, they do not need anything from your end, and they use their college facility to solve the problem. So I work with some students from IIT Kharagpur in this manner. So this was a direct connect that I just sent to some alumni group. I sent some email chatting from this company to me.
Yeah. Did we get this slide?
Yeah, yeah. These slides will be part of the site. You can download them.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
No.
In India, it is a in rural places, like mobile usage is very less. They will use mobile only for picking the call and calling purpose. They will not see the message also. Mm-hmm. How can you be able to push these kind of apps to them?
If they see that something is helping them improve their lifestyle, people will go. Like this holes in the wall is very interesting example, that people see something is available, people are able to make sense out of it, maybe after some struggle they will go behind it. This Kerala fisherman example was another thing. Facebook is a great example. Maybe it's not with the same market, but Facebook is a great example to understand this. So Facebook, what it does, it just solves the problem of displacement. So in this particular presentation, I'm not carrying those slides, so I talk about the evolution of technology. So starting with Google, Yahoo directory listing, and coming to Facebook. So Facebook, how it works, all of us, many of us live a displaced life. We go to US, we go to some country, like my hometown is in UP. So I belong to this place called Itawa in UP. And I'm staying in Bangalore for past 10 years now. So obviously I live here, I pretty much have my contacts, my family, everything here, but at the same time, lot of people I want to be in touch with. I want to share my data, I want to share my photographs, I want to know what is happening in their life. My friends keep moving, people are like, recently I was in the US, and I could hardly meet a few people because people are so globally placed. So somebody is in Washington, I was there in Chicago, I went to Urbana-Champaign, but people are like all across, and it's difficult to meet them. So still you just keep in touch, and Facebook solves that need. So that is why people use Facebook. Nobody gives you incentive to use Facebook, but somewhere you feel connected, somewhere you feel, okay, I can be in touch, and you use. So similarly for these applications for farmers or for emerging markets, if you create that application that people think it can help them, if they understand, maybe you have to go and teach them, you have to educate them, and then if people think, okay, it is helping me, they will use it.
And how you will select the market group, like user group, which kind of user you will identify and go and investigate with them and come back with the feedback from them, like?
So user group, again, there are two things. One thing is you have a market in mind, and you understand the market need, and you solve a problem for them, right? Another thing, you have a solution. Then you try to see who can be using my particular solution, right? So then you identify the market for them. So these are like, so which one you want to like focus on?
Second one you mentioned, right? User group. Not the market.
So you have a solution in hand, you already have a solution in hand, and then you understand the market. WhatsApp is a great example for that. So Apple has iMessage, right? And WhatsApp is nothing but equal to iMessage. But Apple to Apple communication is easy. I mean, you can just share anything using iMessage, and even from my laptop, I use Mac and I use iPad. So I just, so instead of sending something by email, which takes long time to, somehow, I mean, iMessage is very fast. So even if I have to share my presentation just for the backup, and I just put it in the iMessage, connect, and it goes to my, I can copy in my download in the, but if you have to do the same thing with other phones or other devices, other operating systems, it doesn't work, right? So WhatsApp just copied the same idea, and it just made it enable for everything, anything to anything, and everybody is using it. So now you have the concept. There's nothing so innovative, great about it, but at the same time, it's solving problem. It is like useful. So you have a solution. You just try to see who is not able to use it, and maybe you can just replicate that.
Thank you.
Is it audible?
Thank you.